We are ready for the next session. It's titled Creating Your Protagonist, The Agony and the Ecstasy. Our first speaker has an academic background in anthropology. As a traveler, writer, and freelance journalist, he has traveled extensively around Pakistan, documenting historical and cultural heritage. He has written for The News, Express Tribune, The Friday Times, Dawn, Scroll, and Himal. He authored A White Trail, a journey into the heart of Pakistan's religious minorities. His next is Search of Shiva, a study of folk religious practices in Pakistan, followed by Walking with Nanak, an educationalist and a resident of Islamabad. Please welcome Haroon Khalid. She is labeled the Desi Agatha Christie. She has published 8 books. Her The Cosmic Clues has been selected as a killer book by Mystery Booksellers of America. And The Astral Alibi has been honored as notable fiction in the Kiriyama Prize. An independent filmmaker, she is also the founder and the festival director of the Pune International Literary Fest. Her thesis, converted into a book titled Roles, Reels and Real, has become a referral book for students of Hindi cinema. Please welcome Manjari Prabhu. The next speaker is a recipient of the Uttarakhand Ratna 2014. A Haridwar-based writer, she is the author of 3 works of fiction, A Bridge to Nowhere, God is a River, A Story of Faith, and The White Shadow. Her awards among other include the Woman of Substance from the All India Women's Conference, Hindustan Times Woman of the Year Award, Reader's Choice. She writes regularly for HT Online Paper, HMA Annual Souvenir, BHEL Magazines, and various science journals. Please welcome Mona Verma. This speaker is a novelist, poet, playwright, and short fiction writer for both children and adults. Her plays include the award-winning Mangalam, as also Keats Was a Tuba, and Samara's Song, which was shortlisted for BBC and the Hindu Awards respectively. Her short story Amulu was shortlisted for the 2012 Commonwealth Short Story Prize. She has been on the governing body of the National School of Drama and several times on the jury of the Trinity College International Playwriting Competition for Children. As an actor, she has been part of the plays and award-winning films The Outhouse and Shaitan. Please welcome Polly Sengupta. And finally, this speaker is a professor and former chairperson of the English department at Punjab University, Chandigarh. She is a recipient of several national and international fellowships. As a creative writer, she has published a collection of poems, a play, and 3 novels. The latest is Amaryllis Avenue. Former chairperson of the prestigious Chandigarh Sahitya Academy, she is presently the chief functionary of MELO, the Society for the Study of Multi-Ethnic Literature of the World. Amongst other things, please welcome Manju Jedka. And Manju will be moderating today's session. Let's have a very loud applause to set the tone for a very engaging session.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So here we are, this wind-blown afternoon, and we hope to blow you away with a little bit of discussion that we'll have on the stage. The speakers have already been introduced to you, but I will talk about them in a little while. Let me tell you about what we are going to talk about. Here there are four authors, four plus one actually, if I count myself, four authors in search of a character. You know, you've heard about the characters being in search of the author. Here we have four authors in search of a character, and we are wondering what it is that goes into the making of a character, of the protagonist. We are going to talk about the agony and the ecstasy of creating a protagonist. What is the agony and the ecstasy? You know, it's like a creator like Michelangelo creating something out of nothing. So the agony and ecstasy of creating a protagonist. How does it feel? How do you feel? Do you feel like God? Or do you feel like the devil? So do you feel like the devil? You know, sometimes you create a character just out of a sense of mischief, and why not? So you take on that role. How does it feel to create a character? And then, among other questions we will be pondering is this question, this overwhelming question, how much of the protagonist that you create represents you? You know, it was Flaubert who said about Emma Bovary, Emma, c'est moi. Emma, that's me. So when you create your character, is it you yourself that's being reflected in the person that you create? Is it a doppelganger, a double, a reflection? Or is it a wish fulfillment? Is it a wish fulfillment? You know, if you've read your Freud, you would know what Freud says about dreams and wish fulfillment. You would know what he says about creativity being a sort of a wish fulfillment in which all your desires are, you know, they take form in your writing. So what is it that goes into your creativity? What is it that goes into the creating of, to the making of the character? Is your protagonist a surrogate or the expression of your suppressed desires? Or is the protagonist something that might have been, and why not? So, is the protagonist an act of vengeance? You know, sometimes in real life you can't really get at the people who have wronged you. So you create characters sometimes. That is what Dante did, for instance, in the Divine Comedy. You know about the Inferno, the first section of the Divine Comedy, the first book. What he did was he peopled Inferno, that is hell, with all the people from real life who had been mean to him. All the popes and the kings and the dukes and so on, they were all put in the fire of hell. So sometimes we as writers, do we create our characters out of an act of vengeance? Now, other questions, other points that we would like to ponder, the discussion could follow this route, is how, what is it about the character that you create that appeals the most? Yesterday, somebody quoted Umberto Eco and said that nobody identifies with a comic hero, but it's the tragic hero who wins everybody's sympathy. Is that true? Is that true? There was another writer who said, you know, the best way to create a story is to put your character up a tree and start throwing stones at him or her. Is that the way it is done? Is that how you will get the sympathy of your reader? So this is a point we could ponder. And then the different kinds of protagonists that we create. What kind of protagonists do we create in our book? Do we create a hero or an anti-hero? The anti-hero is not the same as the villain. It is a hero with a different face, not the hero-like qualities, but a human being with shades of black and white. So is it the hero, the anti-hero, the villain, the sidekick, or just a filler, or a counterfoil? So what are the kind of protagonists that you would like to create? And then sometimes, you know, when you create a protagonist, you have to create the person larger than life. What do you do when it becomes too large? What do you do when it becomes too large? So large that it becomes kind of like a superhuman being or a Frankenstein. So these are the issues that we hope to take up in this discussion. And we have all these speakers out here. They've already been introduced, but I would like to repeat one or two points about them which are most interesting. At least I find them most fascinating. And at this point, I would like to pause a bit and say that the organizers of the BLF have done a great job in putting together a panel like this. Of course, all the panels have been great, but this, when I was reading up on the writers and their works, I got more and more interested, and like Alice in Wonderland, I was curiouser and curiouser. So now we have Harun Khalid from across the border. He was introduced to you earlier, and what is noteworthy about him is that he has a background in anthropology. So we have anthropology and, hold your breath, not just anthropology, he is interested in black magic. Okay, so he's interested in black magic and he's been a journalist. Now, how does anthropology and black magic go into his writing and how does he create characters? You bet I'm dying to know. And then we have Manjari Prabhu. Manjari Prabhu, she is another interesting person in the sense, not only is she the Desi Agatha Christie, as she's been introduced, but... And I'm sure after the session, there'll be a line of people from the audience waiting to have a talk with her. She is interested in astrology. So it is anthropology and astrology. It'll get better and better, I'm sure. So we have Manjari Prabhu, who's interested in anthropology and astrology and detective fiction and children's literature. So this is a heady mix because children's literature comes up again with the other writers also. So Manjari, Harun, welcome to this session. And then we have Mona. Mona comes from the holy city of Haridwar. So Mona comes from the holy city of Haridwar, and you bet she has a spiritual side to her. So as I told you, it really gets even better. Now she is the author of several books, and the one that we would be discussing is The White Shadow, and which talks about the widows of Banaras. This is a different subject altogether from astrology and from anthropology. So it takes us in a different direction. We'll be talking more about it. But let me tell you something about the fourth speaker that we have, Poyali. Poyali is as interesting as her name. Incidentally, the name that she was given when she was born was Ambika. Ambika Balakrishnan. But then, Gopalakrishnan. But then, you know, she was born to create characters, born to create protagonists. So she just created a protagonist in herself, that is Poyali. Poyali is here, Poyali Sen Gupta. And she, as well, you've been introduced to her, she's been writing for decades now. She's been writing for children, and now she's come up with her first novel, which has another interesting title, Inga. So, Harun, Manjari, Mona, Poyali, welcome to this session. And we are going to start now. Let me see, the format that I have in mind is that we'll go around, and the introductions are over. We will go around and I will ask you to talk about how you actually give birth to your characters. How is the protagonist born? And then we'll talk about the characters that you have created, anything special about them that appeals to you or that you identify with. And the rest of the discussion will take offshoots from these particular topics. All right, so should we begin with you, Harun?
Sure.
Harun, all right, Harun. Now, Harun, tell me about the things that interest you, and in particular, how do you delve into the psyche of your characters that you're not familiar with? And, you know, there are characters that you're not familiar with. For instance, Harun writes about minorities in Pakistan. So Hindus in Pakistan, you may not have much of familiarity with them. How do you manage to go into their minds? And then, which is even more interesting is, you talk about Badruhe, bad spirits. How do you go into the mind of bad spirits? There are so many questions that come up, but Harun, I'll let you talk.
Right. Thank you. Well, first of all, I would like to say I'm honored to be on the stage with so many such esteemed writers. I'm still very new to the field, and I've always written nonfiction, and I've just sort of delved into fiction with my last book. But as you mentioned, my first book is about minorities in Pakistan. It's narrative journalism, where I've sort of tried explaining the stories of minorities, not in an academic manner, but more of a narrative fictionalized way. So, for example, the book starts with this Hindu woman sitting in Multan making her roti, and suddenly she hears a mob outside, which is coming to burn her. And then leaving her roti as it is on the chula, she goes, she collects her mom, and she runs in the streets without a dupatta, as she pointed out. So that's the kind of sort of work I've done with minorities. All my stories have been told. With such topics, though, it's really, you have to, I mean, it's a cross between fiction and journalism. You have to allow, for me, the goal was to make the story more readable. So I essentially write what I wanted to read. And that's just one reason why I chose this particular format. But I think what I'd like to talk about right now is my latest venture, which is perhaps more appropriate with this topic, which is about Guru Nanak. So I've written a book, which will be published in April. And it's a book, it's half fiction and half non-fiction. And I know that I'm prepared to be killed and thrashed by critics, but it's just something I wanted to explore. So what I've done is I've explored the story of Guru Nanak as a fictionalized character. And the second half of the book is me exploring those places where Guru Nanak has visited and trying to understand what Nanak meant. Now, so my process for this was actually quite the opposite of what usually is for writers. You have to imagine a character, and you have to make sure that you don't make him or her larger than life. But here, you had a historical character, and not just a historical character, but a religious character. And all the stories you heard about him were all of his miracles. And I had this character, and I had to reduce him to life. That's my goal was. I wanted to see what the real personality of Guru Nanak was. So I think the technique that I used was, as opposed to looking at the myths, I delve into his writing. Because as you mentioned earlier, your character is essentially a reflection of yourself. Your writing is a reflection of yourself. And I thought the only way I could really understand the character of Nanak was to read his poetry. So my sort of character of Guru Nanak, and I essentially believe, it's not an objective depiction. It's my perception of what I think Guru Nanak is. So using his poetry, I sort of talked about what the character is, what were some of his limitations, perhaps, or what were some of the struggles that he went through to become who he became. And of course, so in the book, I also talk about how I sort of taking that similar journey that Nanak did, understand what his pilgrimage meant, what his sort of life was all about. So I guess that's what the book will be about.
Thank you, Harun. Harun, that is about Nanak, walking with Nanak. But we will come back to you in a short while, and we would like to hear a little more about the bad spirits, about the Badruhe. But let's get on to Manjiri. Manjiri Prabhu, would you have anything to say about the characters that you create?
Well, first and foremost, I think I don't create the characters. The characters just come into my life. That's always been true to me. I have always seen my characters, whether they are in dreams, or whether, just out of the blue, they just stand in front of me. It's like they're almost in the side wings. Yeah, it's almost as if they're in the side wings, and then suddenly they pop up when they need to be brought in the forefront. And I've always had this experience. So I'll particularly limit myself to Sonia Samarth, who's an astro detective in my series called The Cosmic Clues and Stellar Signs. So she is... She's India's or the world's first astro detective.
Does that mean that she uses astrology to solve her mysteries?
That's right.
Wow.
So apart from all the normal deductive methods, she uses astrology, which Vedic astrology, which means she uses horoscopes. And she has, apart from astrology, she also has another very weird characteristic, and that is that she dances with wild abandon to loud, jarring music. Now, this is something I saw Sonia.
Like the dance of the dervishes.
Yeah, okay. So I literally saw Sonia, and it wasn't an imagination. I saw her. It was like a vision. And all I did was really just put her in a plot that was convenient to me and to her. So for me, characters come to me. And like he said, even I grew with Sonia. You know, because Sonia's entire journey, no one believed her when she started using astrology as a tool for crime solving. And towards the end of the book, they realized that she actually had something. So her entire journey, I lived with her. I made the same mistakes. I did the same discovery. So it was a discovery process for me too. I grew with her.
I must tell the audience that Manjeri's mother is an astrologer. And that is the reason why astrology comes into her work such a lot. Also, Manjeri, when you talk about it, I get the feeling that you are like the inspired bard, you know, the inspired prophet of old. While in a frenzy, while in a trance, you are the most creative. Yeah. Is that right?
Yes, to an extent. I wish it was completely like that. But yes, I do feel that we are just all channels. And it's the divine creativity just flows through us, and I believe in that. So I normally don't sit down and chalk out characters. I just wait for them to come to me.
Wonderful. Be sure that you take some tips from Manjeri before you leave. But we will move on to Mona Verma. Mona, let's have your take on the subject.
Well, having heard Harun and Manjeri just now, I'm reminded of Anthony de Mello. Anthony de Mello once said that you have to understand that the shortest distance between truth and human being will always be a story. As a story writer, I have a voice of a protagonist, a voice of an antagonist too. But no two people will ever hear the same voice when I'm carving them. When we are writing fiction, fiction, I believe, insinuates itself across experiences, across boundaries, both physical as well as emotional. And it is a foil to what lies inside us. Fiction will certainly and always be cathartic to an extent. And when we are crafting these characters, as Harun just mentioned, that they are these larger than life characters, as opposed to the dark, conflicted souls. But it is not the dark, conflicted soul that makes up your character or the larger than life. What are we people? We are not the 50 shades, we are the 50 million shades that go into the filling between the larger than life and the dark, conflicted character. For example, if you see the character of Sherlock Holmes, people find him queer. And there was an unassuming, bespectacled boy called Harry Potter. But once they enter your think space, my protagonist should not be able to leave your think space. This is what I aim at when I'm writing. In The White Shadow, I'm looking at the characters of Debi and Brinda, young child widows. There's a life that they can live, but the life they cannot live. Along with this, I'm sharing this with the law of karma and very potent thread from Bhagavad Gita, because I strongly feel that religious scriptures are fearing an elimination from children's mind that is constantly on a digital diet. Hence, I wanted to rewrite you those stories. As Harun just said, that rewriting a story or retelling a story, we tend to humanize the characters a little more. So when we retell them, somebody is able to connect with that particular thread, which they found intimidating a little earlier. And sometimes what happens when you're writing, there's no emotion that washes up ashore for a long, long time. But when you start, close your eyes and think about the character, get into the character's head and pull that character into your mind, start understanding him, then words spill unbroken onto paper. And you can't make your character very, very intimidating for your readers, because even if he's a protagonist or an antagonist, there has to be a motivation for him to be there in that story. He has to serve a purpose in the story. And I have to bring my reader into my story. That is my purpose when I'm writing a story.
You remember what I said about spirituality and Mona? Well, there she is. What she said just reminded me of how Wordsworth defined creativity. He said it's the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings, but it takes its origin from emotion recollected in tranquility. So you may be some distance in time away from the experience, but the experience comes back with full force, and then it overwhelms you, and you just have to write. There's no getting away from it.
You always have a personal experience and a history to borrow from, always, for that matter.
Let me move on to the next speaker, that is Poili Sengupta. And before I ask her to speak, I want to read out a couple of lines to you. If anyone could transform laughter to light, she did, Inga. She has created Inga. If anyone could transform laughter to light, she did, Inga. Radiance upon radiance of laughter, chime upon bell chime of light, sparkled and shone everywhere. It was as if the sky showered tiny star grains that scattered glinting on the hay heap we were cocooned in. They sparkled on the leaves of the jackfruit tree above and dusted my arms with gold. Who could resist such a dance of light? I couldn't. I never could. Almost never. It gives me goosebumps, Poily. Please tell me about your characters.
Gosh, I'm so nervous. After Harun and Manjari and Mona, what am I to say? I need to say right in the beginning that my protagonist, I think, is not a character at all. Because if I compare a piece of dramatic fiction or non-dramatic fiction, it is a composition, like a sculpture, a painting, a musical composition. I would not go to my sculpture friend and ask her, who is your protagonist? And how was your protagonist born? So if I look at my work and I ask myself, who is my protagonist, I wouldn't know. Because in Inga is not the protagonist as far as I can see. So then, is it the idea? Is it the idea that took into itself the unfolding of different characters? Is that the protagonist? Maybe that's what it is. It is that first idea that was born. And in this case, the idea that I started off with was the trigger, was that I met a lot of people from the LGBT community. My daughter was working with them. And I met them, and I talked to them, and we had meals together. And I asked myself, what is the language that they speak? That they use with each other? What are the endearments that they use? And well, it's the same language that heterosexual couples use. What is the difference? And then I say, what is the difference? It is the same relationship. It has the same intensity. It has the same passion. It has the same scope for misunderstanding. It has the same scope for quarrels and fights. And all of that, it has the same scope for agony and ecstasy. So I wrote Inga. But my character, the main character, the dictionary meaning of protagonist is the leading character. Who is the leading character? I don't know. As a dramatist, when you do a play, you say in order of appearance. You don't give anyone importance over any other. And so that is what I carried into my novel as well. But certainly, I had a character who gave shape to the thoughts I had. She is Rapa, the narrator of Inga, and she is an obsessive character, and I'm afraid to say rather dislikable. She lived with me, as Manjari talks of her characters, she lived with me, and I'll tell you, she was a veritable demon. She was. And Harun, she also thought of sorcery. But there is her alter ego, that's Inga, who had the power of healing. And I believe, like Mona does, that all of us, every one of us, has the power to be healers and to be spiritual teachers.
Thank you, Poily. We'll come back up to Inga in a short while, but let me go back to Harun now. Harun, the question that was pending, you talked about Nanak, yeah. I don't think I'm going to ask you how you identify yourself with Nanak, but tell me about the bad spirits that you are interested in. You do talk about them, Badru hai, he calls them Badru hai, bad spirits. Tell us more about it. I'm sure the audience would be very interested.
Okay, so I wrote this story for Himal and then another follow-up story for another magazine called Friday Times in Pakistan. Now, the idea for the story came, I had this aunt who, for a couple of years, was possessed by the devil. And of course, I mean, I've never believed in the story, but for people around her, so for her children, for her brothers and sisters, a very real story. She would have nails in her head, which would come out, and the children would see. She would have marks on her body. She would lift the bed. She would lift the bed with one hand. See, you talk about evil spirits and that's where it starts happening. I was actually warned, by the way, when I was doing the story, so I was interviewing a lot of people who were curers of black magic. And they would warn me, they were like, you should not explore this story. And I was scared for a little while if actually it was happening. But so I was also very interested in studying this whole idea of black magic from an anthropological point of view. That why is it something which is perhaps not real, as I understand, becomes such a real experience? How can somebody get so much power to lift the bed with one hand? So then I started talking to a lot of anthropologists, psychologists, and they actually talked about how that scientifically that could actually come true. If you are in a mental state where you believe that you are possessed, you can somehow sort of incorporate the spirit of a devil inside you, as their view. So that's, and then another really important or interesting aspect of this whole bad spirit and good spirit that I saw, how the good and the bad spirit was also used as a way to make national identity. So and I was doing my research in Lahore, and a lot of these curers of black magic thought of this evil spirit as being Hindus. So there were these evil spirits.
It's very interesting, because you see, it's always the other. It's always the other who is demonized. So if we are Hindus, we would demonize Muslims, and Muslims would demonize Hindus.
Yeah, absolutely. So this was the idea that these were these spirits that had remained back in Lahore after partition. The Hindus forgot to take them to India. And the idea was that you have spirits, good spirits, bad spirits. The Muslim spirits are good spirits, and if you possess them, they will help you. They are like demigods, if you understand. And there's these bad spirits, which are Hindu, and Sikh spirits. So I was very interested in how spirits and black magic sort of was also used to create a national identity. It reminded me of what Manto wrote with Toba Tek Singh about the lunatics of Lahore being Sikh and Hindu lunatics being sent to India, and Muslim lunatics from...
I have the lines here. Should I read them out?
Please.
This is what Harun says. In his famous short story, Toba Tek Singh, Manto refers at one point to the agreement between India and Pakistan a few years after the partition to exchange prisoners and lunatics according to their respective religions. Prisoners and lunatics. The process of exchange, though satirized by Manto, occurred in all seriousness and continued to do so for a long time. But we forgot to exchange ghosts, or what are called badruhe in Urdu. Please continue.
Yeah, so these are two aspects that I was really interested in. The anthropological aspect, why does black magic happen? Why in our societies? And it also gets cured. So it's not like you only get possessed. You also get cured. So my aunt now is completely cured, and she did not go to a psychologist. She had a healer, a black magic healer, who came and who resolved the issue for her. So I was very interested in why and how does that happen. And the second aspect, of course, was on this issue of national identity and how even ghosts can help make us a nation.
You know, Harun, I'm reminded of a friend of mine who worked on the ghost stories of Shimla. And she went around Himachal collecting stories. So she had to knock at several doors and say, aapko koi bhoot ki kahaniyan aati hain? Yahan pe koi bhoot rehta hai? And finally, she had one whole village chasing her, with broomsticks out of the house. So just be careful, you don't meet that fate. Manjari, moving on to Manjari. Tell me a little more about your detective, your female sleuth. And how is she different from the male detectives that we have, male sleuths that we have? And is it by any chance a reflection of your own personality? You partly answered it, but I would like you to go into more detail. Manjari.
Yeah. Sonia Samarth. Yeah, Sonia Samarth is definitely not me. Okay, because she's almost like a perfect person. She's almost like a perfect person. Another very important quality in her is that she's very forgiving. She literally forgives the criminal. And that, I think, is a very dangerous thing to do. She's almost on the borderline of good and bad. I'm a very unforgiving person, so I wouldn't do that. So Sonia is a very, she's a girl of today's world. But her roots are very traditional. But at the same time, she's open to new ideas, which is why she uses astrology to solve crime. And
does she have a Dr. Watson?
She doesn't have a Dr. Watson, but she has a cat called Nidhi, who brings her first case. Or whenever she's down, the cat kind of brings her up. Whenever she's...
Cat lovers, are you listening?
Any cat lovers here? Okay, good. So anyway, so the cat is, plays a very, very important role in the book. And the, and there's also another important character called Monish Rai, who is interested in Sonia, so who's a TV journalist, and an international jewel thief, very filmy, called the Owl. So I've got these little, you know, characters too, but Sonia is the main character, and she's not like me, and I hope that I won't be like her because she's too perfect.
The Owl seem to have traveled from Harun's work to Manjiri's work. Coming to Mona, Mona, tell us a little bit more about your character. Particularly, I'm interested in Brinda. I'm interested in Brinda. And when you talk about the widows of Banaras, I was just wondering if by any chance you were influenced by Deepa Mehta's film Water, you know, where she talks about widows. So if you could tell us a little more about Brinda and what goes into the making of a character like Brinda.
Yes, Brinda is... Can you hear me? Yeah, you can? Okay, yeah, thanks. Brinda is a young girl who gets married at the age of 5. And she's widowed a day after her marriage. And then she comes to this ashram in Banaras. She's left by her father-in-law, Bibhuti, who drops her in this ashram in Banaras. And that is where Brinda grows up. Now, Brinda craves for a life. There's a certain silent voice within her which is struggling to come out at all times. And that is where the matriarch of the ashram, Basanti, tries to calm her frayed nerves with the teachings from the Bhagavad Gita. At so many times, you know, Basanti Bua even resorts to a lie. And when Basanti Bua starts preaching about the Bhagavad Gita, one day Brinda asks her, but you let Debi, another character, escape the ashram with a boy that she loved, a local tourist guy called Sunny. And in the garb of the Ayodhya riots, you told people that she's died, she's lost her life to the riots. Why did you do that? And at that point, Basanti Bua gives her this example from the Bhagavad Gita that in the war of Mahabharata, the Drona, the commander of the Kauravas, was the most indomitable character. Nobody could defeat him. So at that point, Lord Krishna devised a plan. He devised a plan to kill Drona. How he did it? That he had a son called Ashwadhama. So he went to Yudhishthir and told him that we got to scream out that Ashwadhama mara gaya. Yudhishthir, who was the epitome of truth and virtue, said, I certainly cannot do that because I'm not going to lie. To this, Krishna tells him that, no, you are not going to tell a lie in its totality. I'm going to kill an elephant who's also fighting the war. This elephant is also called Ashwadhama. And I'm going to kill Ashwadhama. So you are not going to say that Ashwadhama, the man, was killed. You just say, yes, Ashwadhama mara gaya. And he screams and Drona hears him and he falls to his knees and drops his weapons. But after a moment of grief, he goes running to Yudhishthir and asks him, Yudhishthir, you are the epitome of truth and virtue. You tell me, is my son actually killed? And in a mere whisper, Yudhishthir says, Ashwadhama, Kunjar in Sanskrit is for an elephant, mara gaya. But Drona in his grief hears only what he shouldn't have heard. He heard Ashwadhama mara gaya. He falls to his feet and meditates, goes into deep meditation, and his soul starts escaping his body before Drishtadyuman comes and kills him, actually beheads him. So she says that lie ceases to be a fallen virtue when it serves a bigger purpose. And that is how I let another child widow and you escape the ashram in the garb of the Ayodhya riots, in the garb of a lie, so that you can resurrect your life, you can find a better life. This little child widow picks up her life further using the law of karma and also using the teachings from the Bhagavad Gita to bring other child widows into better life. She starts running the ashram all over again, but without the widows getting their heads tonsured, if somebody does leave their children behind because they are because they've lost their husbands, but they get into the craft of basket weaving or stitching clothes or even finding education for themselves once they do. So this character, I felt, was possibility of a voice for women. Also using the example over there was the example of Phula Sati and Rani Sati that we've also used in this particular book. And this is what really rattled me when I heard and when I read that when Sati culture was abound, these women were actually dipped in ghee. They were dipped in ghee and they were fed opium. So that in an inebriated state, they wouldn't cry out. And people would start beating the dholes and chanting, not to appease any goddess. So best to just, yes, drown their cries so that they won't carry the guilt home. You're killing somebody, but you value your own emotions so much that you do not want to carry that guilt back home. You don't want to have that sleepless night. This is what my characters are all about. And if I'm permitted, I can talk a little about God as a River here. That is also a very personal
maybe
character.
In the next round, maybe. Okay. But tell me, any influence of Deepa Mehta's Water?
No, not really, because the story is really not
similar. It seems to take off.
Except for the fact that, yes, Debi and Brindar are very young girls when they are brought to the ashram. But then their fate doesn't meet the same end as Deepa Mehta's character.
Poyli, you've been talking about your character Inga, and you've told us about Inga and the other character Rapa. So probably they are, you know, one is the counterfoil for the other. But there are other characters also who seem to be archetypal characters in your book. For instance, you have the great aunt. So could you tell us more about the characters that you create according to certain molds, certain archetypes? And whether there is any intrusion of your own personal experiences into these characters' lives. Poyli.
Thank you, Manju. Well, you know, all of us sitting here are actually illusionists. Because we are creating illusions. Can you hear me now? Yeah. All of us are creating illusions. But the paradox of fiction is that these illusions also carry the truth. It's just that you have to peel things out. And because we are creating illusions, we also have a great deal of ambiguity in what we write. All of us are doing that. And the characters that I have, which crowd the novel, Inga, are characters who I created, as Manju said, out of nothing, but they also relate to people when readers read them. Because a lot of my readers came back and said, she's just like my aunt, or she's just like my grandmother, or somebody else is just like my uncle. And so you're creating a fictional character who seems to be very much like a flesh and blood person in someone's own real life. But they are not. And it's because they are not that you can play with them. And you can nuance them. And they don't stay as archetypes because they change, they evolve. And each time someone told me she read the book two or three times, and each time she found something else in the book, something else in the character, something else that she had missed before. It's also a mystery novel because there is a murder and you have to find out who did it. And the clues are all there right in the beginning, but you don't pick them up because the other narrative takes you through. And then you come back to the narrative and you say, oh, I didn't see this before. So it is an organic growth of a novel, as well as the assemblage of factors which create
realistic. I was wondering if you would have anything to say about the characters. You know, sometimes there is one character and you have modeled it on a real life character that is very special. But what do you do when it becomes so special as to become a little incredible? Harun?
I think what I've already said earlier, that my goal was actually the opposite. So I had this special character and I wanted to make him ordinary. But I think what also really resonated with me, but as Poyli mentioned, that it's not your protagonist, it's not your character, it's actually the idea. The idea which is the protagonist, and then that idea creates these other characters.
So how do you make the special character ordinary?
Something that really personally bothers me is how the deification of religious figures, and that happens in all religious traditions. So I think that's something that I wanted to explore, and that was the idea. So that the idea that the protagonist is sort of to humanize something which has already been deified. There's actually no way to there's no one way to do it. But so in my book I have four characters. So Nanak was always accompanied by his companion, who's a Muslim companion, Mardana. And when I'm following his footsteps, literally taking the journey that he did, I'm also followed, I'm accompanied by my mentor. My complete understanding of Nanak, of Mardana, of his journey, and of also his religious philosophy comes from my relationship with my mentor, and also my sort of my interaction with places that Nanak visited. So a lot of times, and it's a little spiritual, but a lot of times I went to a place where Nanak had been, and there's a story associated with it. And in my mind, I could see Nanak there. I felt like I was interacting with him. If there was a tree, I held the tree, and I could actually see myself transformed into that time period. So it was a very interesting engagement for me, once again, personally.
Oh, would you like to add to that, Manjiri?
For me, it has been a little different. I have never tried to create characters that readers can relate to. I have tried to create characters that readers can try to aspire to be. So it's always...
Role models.
Yes. So a little, I've always created all of them to be a little overboard, a little larger than life. So that all of them, they won't be very, very real, but they'll be someone believable, but at the same time, someone you might want to aspire to be. So I'll tell you why I do this, because mystery genre is a little fantastic. Okay, you're not going to meet a murderer every day in life. Okay, so I have
thank heavens.
Yes. So when I try to strike a balance between reality and the fantastic, I want to have a combination of both, which is why the characters become a little larger than life.
What about you, Mona?
Yeah, I believe literature will have a cultural high ground, and with my characters, history is always added to the volume of my character. For example, as I wanted to talk earlier about my book, God is a River, which is set at the turn of the 19th century. And there were so many stories about partition which are there in this book, which are the narratives of people who cross the boundaries. These stories often go undocumented. What we read in the history books sometimes is a little diluted. There are certain aspects that are quite blurred. And these are the stories that you actually get from people, the stories of people, because they tell us that the partition, as stated in my book, God is a River, is not only the story from the era of Warren Hastings to Sir Louis Mountbatten. It was not just the Jallianwala Bagh or the Simon Commission. There were stories of people, stories of real people. Like my grandfather would often tell me, stories that wherever they started from, they always ended in a court moment or Ghakkar Mandi in Pakistan. And after the massacre, he said that there was a sharp oblique between people that he trusted and people he could have trusted. Because he said, when I was leaving Pakistan, I turned to my friends and asked them, "Pathar marne walon ke saath tu bhi saath aa gaya yaar, tera guna to main apne sir liya karta tha." So that was the level of trust that was breached. It was not just the physical slicing of boundaries. It was a loss of faith. And that is what crafted my characters in God as a River.
Thank you, Mona. What she's just told us about is the little stories in criticism, in literary criticism, we call it the little stories versus the grand stories. You know, the grand histories and the little stories. That is what Mona has been focusing on. Because history, as we know, is written by the conqueror. History is written by those in power. It's those who are on the other side of the fence, those who are at the bottom of the ladder. How does history appear to them? That is what Mona has been focusing on. And perhaps, Manjiri, you would also like to one day write about the same story from the point of view of the murderer or from the point of view of the criminal.
Absolutely.
You would like to do that.
Yeah.
But I would like to know what Poily is planning to write in future. And if you have any questions on protagonists, be prepared with them, because very soon we are going to throw the discussion open to the audience. Poily first.
Thank you, Manju. I think one of the things that all of us haven't spoken about but ought to is the material we are using. And the material we are using is like a painter or a sculptor uses raw material. Our raw material is the very ordinary word. And the vocabulary, whichever language it may be, we use it differently from the way we speak it at home, with the family, with people we interact with, and so on. Now, what is this language? How do we use it in our books, how do we transmute, transform this medium, this material, into something that is memorable? I think that is part of what I always explore when I'm writing. And I think that is a challenge that I need to face each time I write, whether it's a short story where I have to use a different register of language. If it's a story for children, then another kind of language. If it's a novel, which is the way I had to live with Rapa and Inga for 7 years, then the language became different. It was set in a period where, for instance, I could not use the phrase, it's okay, because Rapa didn't. She would say, it's all right. Where images have to be different. Say, take the word green. Green in other cultures is green with jealousy. But in India, we use green for tenderness, for that which is not ripe yet. And that is a beautiful way of looking at it. So I'm very, very conscious of the material that I'm using, and I pore over every line for a very long time. I must here take permission from Manju to say something that is personally very painful for me, but which I would like all of you to remember, that when I started writing Inga, I was diagnosed with macular degeneration. I've lost vision in my right eye to the extent of it not there at all. And I would like all of you to please, as soon as you see any distortion of a straight line, if you see a straight line curving, please go immediately to an ophthalmologist. Don't let it stay, because that is the first symptom of macular degeneration. It is irreversible. And I have been struggling with it for the last 10 years. I cannot read. So I've had to contend with this. That has been one of the major challenges. And the fact that Rapa did not exhibit this in her journal entries is something I'm proud of. I didn't let it seep into the writing. But certainly, please take care of yourselves. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing this with us, Poeli. And we wish you all the best in your other future writings also. But the point that Poeli made just now is an important point to remember, those of you who are planning to be writers or who are writing, that you must have your target audience in mind. Who are you writing for? Are you writing for children? Are you writing for the young adult? Are you writing something like chick lit, which will go down to, you know, the teeny boppers around you? Or are you writing serious, mature fiction? So have your target audience in mind and create your protagonist accordingly. But let me see if there are any questions from the audience. I can see one hand going up, two and three. Okay, we'll stop at these three. That the gentleman in the white shirt at the back.
My name is Anshul. My question is, how important is internal conflict for a protagonist and a character arc across the story? So if there is a confusion, and how important is the internal resolution for that confusion? Not to anybody in particular, but yeah, whoever can answer.
Who would like to answer? Mona?
Same. Yeah, you're talking about the internal conflict inside the author's mind. When we are shaping a protagonist, we must understand that we are talking about people. People we see in everyday's life. And normal people, people like you and me, are deeply conflicted within. We are deeply flawed people within. And this is what makes us connect with each other. Hence, when we are shaping the character, we are not shaping them in shades of white or black or gray. We are shaping them in way they form a basis of larger motivation of the story that is to follow. So whatever is there in my mind and my heart, then has to come together as this character. And it could be deeply conflicted. I don't have to make my character very, very likable. I have to draw you to my unlikable character also.
There were two questions from this side. Yes, let's have both the questions together. The girl in front, yes.
And my question is just out of curiosity. Have you ever been scared that your protagonist won't be accepted by people?
Sorry. Will not be accepted by the reader. And the other question, the lady at the back.
Hi, my name is Avi, and is this audible?
Yes.
Now? Okay. So my question is about a moral universe that you create when you're writing a novel. Like, for example, the ethics and, you know, the etiquette that was acceptable when Ramayana was written, or in the book Ramayana, change with, of course, Mahabharat. And like you narrated the incidents of Krishna, you know, actually plotting and scheming, it had become an acceptable trend by then. So there is a moral degeneration, certainly, that you see from Ramayana to Mahabharata.
Question, please.
And subsequently. So as authors, where do you feel that, you know, let's say we say posterity is, you know, is the judgment of a good literature from bad literature, what distinguishes between the two. How do you, you know, make your characters, like Manjari mentioned, aspirational for the younger generation and, you know, make them... maybe not larger than life, but people who face day-to-day problems and the way they face challenges differently.
Okay, fine. I get it. The question is, how do you make your characters role models? And all four writers are going to get one line, if with your permission, speakers. Huh? How do you, have you ever been apprehensive that your character will not be accepted by the reader? I personally was very apprehensive because I was writing about a super mom. And I was writing about a super mom who was also doing a profession and bringing up her children and coping with all sorts of jealous male colleagues and so on. And believe me, all super moms here and there and everywhere else, they suffer the same problems. But when you don't realize it, but when you start writing about it, then, you know, the super mom becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. And then at the end of it, I said, oh, my God, nobody is going to say that this is one woman who is facing everything. So what I did was I split the character into two. So one was the character and the other was her friend, maybe like Inga Rapa or something like that. So that made the whole thing more credible. But answering the second question, okay, one line answers each of you.
So what's the question again? So, okay.
No. How do you make a role model, ideal role model?
It is acceptable that all the vices are acceptable.
All right. Right. I mean, as I mentioned...
How do you create an ideal character?
Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, my goal was to take an ideal character and make him conflicted. And that also links back to your question. For me, the conflict resolution... So I wanted to show Nanak as somebody who had conflict, and my goal was not to resolve those conflicts. In fact, my goal was quite the opposite, to sort of transform those conflicts into a reader. I wanted the reader also to be part of the
process. Thank you, Arun. Manjari, what about you?
I think to make an aspirational character, you have to take from reality. Even in reality, when you see somebody who's inspired you, who's overcome adversities and led to a victorious end or a successful end, you get inspired, and that is an aspirational person in real life. So in fiction also, if you have a character who overcomes adversities and reaches an end, she's aspirational.
Mona.
Yes, I believe there's nothing really kind of an aspirational character, you know. I read her, as I said, that every book has one voice, but there are no two readers who hear the same voice.
Poily.
Yeah. Thank you, Manju. I don't think literature, good literature, is prescriptive at all. I think it's up to the reader. And what we are all doing, all five of us, is that we are creating oceans of awareness of the other. I, in Inga, is trying to show that the LGBT community is just like us. And Manjari and Mona and Harun and Manju are all doing the same. We create awareness, and that awareness makes us, the reader, more sympathetic, more empathetic, more knowledgeable, more informed. And I think that's a great thing, to be more informed. Like Ramchandra Guha said yesterday, what happens when a state goes against the intellectual, the thinker, becomes anti-thinker, anti-intellectual, that's when all of us have our downfall. As in the Sanskrit, which says, vidvatvam cha nripatvam cha naivatulyam kadachana swadeshehi pujyate raja vidvan sarvatra pujyate. There is no comparison between scholarship and kingship or leadership, because the leader is respected only in his own kingdom or in his own jurisdiction. The scholar, the writer, that creative person is respected everywhere.
On that note, we will conclude. Harun, Manjiri, Mona, and Poily, thank you very much. And thank you for being such a great audience. Thank you. Enjoy the evening.